Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda today is a roundtable on violence in schools. The committee is aware of a number of incidents of violent behaviour which have taken place in schools across Scotland over the past year. We wanted to understand more about these incidents, so we have arranged this roundtable to hear from a range of different voices on this issue. In particular, the committee is keen to understand how common incidents of violence in schools are, which factors contribute to such incidents taking place in our schools, and what could be done to help students, parents and teachers. So can I welcome our witnesses in no particular order? I have Anne Keenan, Assistant Secretary of EIS Scotland, Mike Corbett, National Officer for Scotland at the National Association of Schoolmasters Union of Women Teachers, Bo Johnson, a member of the Scottish Youth Parliament. I'm doing this so I can figure out where everybody is as well. Carrie Lindsay, Executive Director of Education and Children's Services at the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland. Dr. Colin Morrison, hello, Co-Director of the Children's Parliament. Nick Smiley, Chair of the Association, thank you, of Scottish Principal Education Psychologists. Dr. Joan Mowat, Senior Lecturer in the School of Education at the University of Strathclyde, and Cheryl Burnett, Chair of National Parent Forum of Scotland. So thank you all for joining us today. We have a bit of housekeeping to begin. The session is a round table, and it is intended to be more of a conversation rather than the question and answer session we give and put through our government ministers that come to visit us. So members will pose questions to help create a structure for our discussion. However, if you want to come in during the session, please catch my eye or one of the clerks that are sitting to my left, and I'll do my best to bring you in. Okay, so thank you. And I was hoping to start off with the first opening question today, just to set the scene. And I'll pass it to Cheryl Burnett first, if that's okay. So does the panel think that we are currently have a clear picture of the violence that is taking place in schools across Scotland?
For the National Parent Forum, we've recently conducted a survey launched last week on response to parent concerns and complaints that have been raised regarding behaviour in schools and the term violence in schools. We have seen a rise in the sort of the formation of all the issues arising. It's something it's culturally always happened, if we be really honest. It's always within a school building, within our communities. But I think the rise, again, post-COVID has really brought this to fruition. So yes, overwhelmingly, parents have agreed that our interim results show that.
Thanks, Cheryl. Mike Corbett, can I ask you to respond to that, please?
In response to the direct question, I presume you, the committee, we the people.
Yes.
Right, okay. I think we as an organisation, via our members, certainly do. I think the initial point I would make, though, is that this has been around as an issue for a while. So if you look back at 2019 and survey figures we had of members then, they were reporting that verbal abuse was an issue for about 55% of our members, and physical assault was an issue for about 13% of our members. Now, if you look at the most recent figures we have, that has risen. So we're now 60-odd percent talking about verbal abuse in the past year, 17% talking about physical assault in the past year. And I think it's important to make that point that, yes, I think there has been an increase post-COVID, but it's clearly not the only issue. It's been around for a while, but it's useful that we're in this forum today and that, you know, the Cabinet Secretary has announced a summit on this so that we can get this acknowledged and hopefully start trying to address it.
Can I ask Anne to respond as well? Thanks. Anne Keenan, sorry. I'm using your first names and full names for broadcasting. If it seems a bit formal, it's just so they can zoom in.
Thanks very much. I would agree with what Mike has said about this being with us for some time. The EIS has long supported members in dealing with issues around violence and around distress behaviours. And, you know, it's something that we've campaigned for in terms of increased funding, particularly around ASN. Most recently, we have seen, and post-COVID, more and more comments from members and reports from our reps that this is a rising issue. And we had our AGM in Aviemore at the weekend, and I have to say that that was a significant focus of a number of the motions that were brought before us, was this rising need. We had our national executive yesterday, and again, it was a topic of discussion. And unsurprisingly, as a result of an all-member survey that we did, this was a large feature. And you'll have seen from our written evidence that we've published a number of the findings from our members in relation to that survey. So we have almost three quarters of respondents to that survey indicating that they were stressed frequently or all of the time. But when you start to underpin and look at what comes beneath that, 53% of secondary school respondents said that improved pupil behaviour would have the biggest impact on their well-being. Then 71% of secondary school respondents said that managing behaviour was the biggest driver of workload. And we know particularly from colleagues who are in pastoral support and senior management teams that that can be a particular issue for them. If you look at the primary sector, 65.2% of respondents indicated that the biggest impact on their well-being would be having more classroom assistance and more support for for inclusion in ESN, with 70% saying that that would assist their workload more. So there's clearly a feeling from our members that there is an issue that has to be dealt with. And unsurprisingly, we have now launched our campaign, which looks at ESN workload, but importantly, pupil behaviour, to respond to those requests from our members.
And I think as our conversation goes on today, I'm sure some of the members might pick up on those. And this is going to be a bit structured, this bit, while I'm trying to get everyone involved. Can I come to Nick Smiley, please?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. I think, obviously, you know, you'll see from the papers that have been submitted that in terms of concerns around behaviour in school, this is something that has been around for a long time, and there has been a national approach and a lot of work done in this area. But there is no doubt, I think, that the current context is becoming more challenging, and there are issues that we're all facing, and the impact on teachers, as our union colleagues are telling us, is significant. But I think we have to bear in mind that the factors that underlie this can't be sort of captured in a very black and white way. It's complex in terms of the factors that affect children's behaviour, and the factors that are in play just now, particularly post-pandemic, have been significant, I think, in terms of what we're dealing with. We have seen an impact in terms of particularly younger children, in terms of their behaviour and communication and capacity to cope in a school setting, and distress behaviour is what we're dealing with, and is proving a bit of a challenge, I would say, across all of our schools and early learning and childcare centres. There's also the impact at a secondary school level in terms of young people's mental health is still a big concern for us. And the impact on attendance, etc. So it's an issue that people have been concerned about for a long time, but I think there are factors in play just now that's making it a more complex and more challenging issue, and it's something that we're going to have to get to grips with in terms of how we support schools to address this issue. It's not something that schools can tackle on their own, and I think, as has been mentioned before, behaviour, it's a reflection, it's a societal issue as well as a school issue, and it can't just be looked at through the lens of what happens in a school.
Can I ask Bo Johnson to come in next? Thanks.
I think Nick brought up a lot of points that are very relevant to us at Scottish Youth Parliament personally, and as a member of Scottish Youth Parliament, we don't feel there's been enough consultation with children and young people on this issue to gather their views on it. particularly because at SYP, a lot of our work is brought to us by children and young people themselves, and the issues that they feel are most important kind of guide our work and what we prioritise in terms of our campaigns and our policy work and things like that. And this isn't an issue that has been brought to us, which suggests that it's maybe not at the top of children and young people's priorities, as opposed to our kind of things like educational attainment and the education reform, things like mental health and better support for mental health, UNCRC incorporation, things like that. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's not an issue for young people. It's just not top of priorities, and I think there needs to be more consultation with children and young people on that.
Thank you. Can I... So I know you're keen to come back in, Cheryl, but I was keen to get everyone to come in initially. Carrie, would you like to respond to that initial question, please?
Yeah, I suppose the question about whether there's a clear picture is quite a good question, because the data that we have perhaps uses slightly different definitions in different places, because there isn't a firm definition about what violence or distressed behaviour is that people possibly use. And there are different systems that are used to record incidents. So I think that we have a lot of information, but I don't think we have that full picture. And I agree absolutely with Bo. I think that to be working with our children and young people, that particularly the health and wellbeing census gives a lot of information about how we can start to gather that. And there are lots of, some local authorities are having samples in particular schools asking the young people, do they feel safe and what things do they feel could be done? So I think there's a perception in the media that's been put out there of individual situations that have happened that have been quite serious, that are not necessarily as prevalent as perhaps it would appear from the media. And I think that that gives almost a social norm effect where people, young people, are believing that that might be happening everywhere. And I think that's where it is really important to have those conversations with our young people, to be gathering their views about what their experiences are in schools, along with parents and along with staff. But I certainly agree with Bo on that. So I think the clear picture isn't yet there. I think that Education Scotland are doing a report, I believe, that we're expecting in July. Hopefully that will give us a bit more information. As I say, the Health and Wellbeing Census will give us some information. We have been gathering some data as Directors of Education, looking at the statistics across some of our local authorities. So we're certainly starting to build a picture, but there's not that clear national picture at the moment, I wouldn't say.
OK. And Dr Morrison, Dr Colin Morrison. Hold on, it's not your mic, it's Stephanie.
I think the initial problem for us is the whole framing of this discussion, and in fact, with respect with the question, there's no definition about what we're talking about here. So, first of all, if we're talking about violence, a working definition for us would be violence is defined as behaviour by people against people liable to cause physical or psychological harm. So is that what we're talking about today? So if it is, that gives the discussion some kind of parameters that we can all understand. If we're talking about behaviour, for us, we would then talk about relationships. We have worked over the last 30 years alongside some amazing school-based colleagues, not just teachers. We need to remember there are many adults in a school setting. Worked with all those adults and children to change things like behaviour policies to relationship policies. And when you do that, you change the whole way of being and the culture of a school. This is not just about the kind of practices that people can adopt, like restorative practices or whatever. This is about, it's a hearts and minds piece. And if you change the nature of your relationships, then you address challenges and difficulties in those relationships. So our schools are not places of violence. They may be places where incidents happen, but to paint this picture that we have a problem of violence in schools does not reflect the day-to-day experiences of teachers who go in with love and nurture and hard work and build relationships with children and focus on learning and teaching. That's what happens in our schools day-to-day. So I'm concerned about the framing of it. I know we'll dig deep now, but I just think it's really dangerous of us to develop this narrative that our schools are dangerous places and places of violence, because they're not.
I'm not quite sure that's how we had framed today. We're just trying to understand a bit more about what's going on. But can I bring in Dr. Mowat, please?
Thank you. First of all, I agree with a lot of what Nick said, and I won't pick up on the framing issue, but I agreed with, in principle, with a lot of what was said there. I think I would like to frame my response within recognising that there are current concerns around violence and behaviour in schools, but I think Scottish education has a great deal to be proud of. There's been a significant cultural change in Scottish schools, a much greater recognition of underlying reasons for why children behave in the ways that they do, and it's led to a much more empathetic approach towards children, with relationships, trust and children's rights to the fore. And that's been a significant change that I have seen going back to my own days of being a deputy head working in a deprived area. However, I think cultural change is a very difficult thing to achieve. It doesn't happen overnight. It takes a lot of work and it takes time. So I think it's very, very important that we continue with the approaches that we're adopting at the moment, but look to see how they can be improved. In terms of responding to your question about do we have the data, and I don't really think that we do, to be honest, in terms of the national picture, because the behaviour survey was delayed by 2 years, so it's actually almost 6 years since we had the last behaviour survey. We're still waiting to find out the data for the current, for exclusions in terms of violence in schools, assault in schools. That hasn't been published yet for the period since more recently, and I think if we look at the comparison between the two latest sets, they're not a true comparison because the fact that schools were closed during a lot of that time. So I think there's a lot of data emerging from third sector organisations, which is very, very valuable. But in terms of the national picture, I think it's, we're not quite there yet. But I think we'll have a much clearer position perhaps at the end of the year when the behaviour survey comes out and when the statistics come out for the next set of exclusions in schools. To pick up on the point about the impact of COVID, for the last 2 years, my research has been focusing on the impact of COVID on children and families, looking more from a literature perspective, not just in Scotland but internationally. And there's a very strong message coming out about the mental health impacts of COVID on children and young people. That inevitably impacts upon their behaviour. And I think to pick up on some of what Colin was saying, very often manifestations of what might be described as violent behaviour or assaults are often a sign of distressed children. And I think it's important to frame it in that way. I feel that schools are working very, very hard to support to support children and young people and families. And that's what I'm hearing in the small-scale study that I'm conducting just now, looking at how prospective head teachers have been supporting their school communities. And to be honest, they've gone the second mile. Okay. So I think schools are working very, very hard to support children, not just in terms of lost learning, but in terms of their well-being, and I think we need to put the emphasis on well-being.
I'm hoping we'll come into more of those, because I was just trying to have a sort of an opening question there, Dr. Mowat, to get the discussion going, so we've got a sense of where people were. And I know Stephen was wanting to come in, and I've got Mike, and I've got Cheryl. So, Stephen.
Yeah, so there's a whole bunch of stuff that's been raised in the opening comments, and it's tempting to go in about 100 different directions with some of the things that have been said. Things that are easy to agree with because they're lovely principles, and then there's the reality. And we've got the meeting, I think, of those two situations here. We've got nice words and lovely ideas, and then we've got the reality of what teachers are telling many of us is their daily experience in some of Scotland's schools and some of Scotland's classrooms. But I think I'd maybe turn to Carrie, because I think, Carrie, if you don't mind me saying, I think you hit the nail on the head. I don't think we actually know exactly what's happening in our classrooms because we've got such a variation of standard of reporting. And I think, I mean, I ask for comments on this, but what I think we need to do is at least agree that there needs to be a common standard for across Scotland on when situations that happen in a classroom or happen in a school and end up being reportable. Because at the minute, again, anecdotally, because that's all we're reduced to in a lot of these discussions, anecdotes, we get told that, you know, and I've certainly been told by quite a few teachers that they're positively discouraged from reporting some of the things that happen in their classrooms, and are told not to make a fuss about it, even though in some cases people have been off work or even hospitalised.
The specific subjects around the data element were something that one of our other members was going to pick up a bit later on, Stephen.
Oh, OK.
Sorry, but that's fine. I know we're meant to be fostering a discussion. But so we'll take that point and we'll leave that there, and then can I come to Mike and Cheryl, please? Thanks.
Thank you. Still on scale and just building on some of the points that have been made, I think it is useful, Colin, to try and establish, well, what definition of violence are we talking about? For ourselves, we would go with the Health and Safety Executive definition, but it is important that we define what we're talking about in the first instance. But in terms of scale, we've had mention of the Behaviour in Scottish Schools Research study, which has been delayed, and we will get that later in the year, and that will prove a point of comparison, obviously. But even then, that's quite limited in its scope. So we would be saying, you know, there are still potentially question marks about that, but that will help in terms of the data. That's not going to be available until later in the year. And just to reinforce the point that's just been made about reporting, there are a huge variety in terms of reporting systems, and it's not just because she's here, but Fife Council, our members in Fife, say that Fife has done a lot of work recently to make it much easier for teachers to report incidents. And you compare that, and I'm not going to name and shame, but you compare that to some other areas where it's a Byzantine system to try and actually get a report in of a violent incident. And the last but one, I do think the results of the national discussion need to come into this. I know Bo has said it's maybe not coming to the Youth Parliament being an issue, but the results of the national discussion and the consultation with pupils there made it very clear that a number of pupils say they do not feel safe in school at the moment. And the final point, though, is that we still do need to take a step back and acknowledge that there's great things happening in schools. There's been a lot of progress in terms of behaviour, but the focus today is about what is an issue, what our members are telling us is an issue. So for me, that's why we're talking about it today.
Thank you, Mike. Cheryl, do you want to come in before I go to Pam?
Thank you. It's just in response to what you talked about, the definitions. You're right. For us, it's about the behaviour. It's about the relationships that we have with our kids in school and making sure, obviously, their focus is on learning. But what we also have to reflect on, that there is a significant number of children and young people impacted. Again, I agree with the mental health and wellbeing. We're seeing as parents, our kids are really stressed and anxious. Some of them are refusing to go to school. Their behaviour is altered in school as a result of whatever has happened, whether it be through all the different sort of, if it's within the home, if it's within the community, within the school setting itself. If it's, a definition breaking down, what do you mean by behaviour? Is it a bullying behaviour? Is it an impact on mental health? Is it an additional support need, specifically learning support need orientated? But to go on the point of reporting, our initial results of our survey has shown that over half of the parents that we have surveyed so far do not feel their children are safe in school. And that's quite a damning response for us, because as a parent, you put your child to school, you want to ensure that they're safe, and they're like, exactly like Colin spoke about, being nurtured, being safe and supported. And if you're seeing that duality of the children don't feel safe at school and the staff don't feel safe at school, then the system, their system's broken and it needs to change. So I'm welcoming this discussion around finding ways forward to resolve some of these issues that are long term. Say it's not something new, as the previous colleague said.
Thank you, Cheryl. Pam Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, convener, and thank you everyone for joining us this morning and for sharing the information you have in advance, which has been incredibly useful. I want to pick up on some of the discussion we've had so far, because I think it does feed into this issue of identification of the scale of the problem. I am a bit concerned that we might fall, even this morning, we're falling into the trap of suggesting that there isn't the problem that there actually is. And we've heard from Mike and Anne and others about the increases that they're seeing in the environment in schools. I think it's fair to say that we shouldn't look at what the certain newspapers might print on their front page about it. But actually, the low-level indiscipline that's been raised with us is wearing on staff. It's causing the wellbeing issues that Mike and Anne have highlighted. And I think we're creating a bit of a pressure cooker environment in classrooms. Before I ask my question, I want to make the point that I agree with Dr. Mowat and her analysis of the distress behaviours and with Nick Smiley, there's distress here for young people, and we have to get to the bottom of why that is in order to support them to better develop through their education. But my concern is that, first of all, why do we have that inconsistent approach to reporting? And why do some people say that they're scared to escalate it, and when they try to escalate it, it's not taken seriously, and that they're told there's a fear of bringing the authority into disrepute if they do? I think that culture has to be addressed if we're to get to the bottom of this. And so I guess my question would be to Anne, Mike and Carrie, please.
Anne, would you like to kick off with that one? Thanks.
Thank you. Absolutely, and I'm glad, Pam, if I can just mention at the beginning, you brought up the issue of low-level disruptive behaviour, because the feedback we get from members is that persistent low-level disruptive behaviour can actually be a huge increase in stress and in mental health and well-being of teachers. So I appreciate we're talking about definitions here, we're talking about violence, but that is also something that we need to look at in terms of improving the mental health and well-being of teachers and staff in general in schools. Looking at the reporting issue and the recording, the feedback we have got from members is that it is incredibly variable, that a particular issue can be that there is not the support for staff in terms of being given time to make that reporting. There's also the concern that a lot of staff, or the feedback we have from members, is that if a staff has been involved in an incident, then they're not necessarily given time to recover from that incident, to consider the reporting issue. Some of the forms are particularly labour intensive. We know from members that they have huge, they have excessive workload. That can in fact add to that workload if they've been asked to complete those forms. And depending on the number of times that they have to complete the forms, there is almost a kind of wearing down effect, because the feedback is, and this was also from some head teachers in our DHT and HT network, was that the forms are completed, they are then sent to the local authority, and they get no feedback as to what should happen thereafter. So there's a perception that they are in, I think one of our head teachers referred to as an infinite risk assessment process, where they're being asked to complete forms, do a risk assessment, but no additional resourcing is given to be able to address the underlying causes of the distressed or violent behaviour. And I agree that this has to be framed in the context of additional support needs. I'm not saying that every child with an additional support needs has a prospect of, being violent. What we are saying is that if a child or young person is displaying distressed or violent behaviour, then there's potentially an additional support need that needs to be addressed, and we need to get to the underlying cause of that. So by not actually providing the resources to be able to do that, that's a huge problem. And the reporting element is from our members' perspective, feeding into that. There's no consistency. We would like to see a return to the collation of national statistics in relation to this, so that we can have some comparison. And for forums to be as straightforward and as simple as possible, so that salient information can be gathered consistently across the piece, it's not adding to workload, and that mechanisms are in place where people are not being discouraged from doing so. There is, of course, the concern that, some people may, some schools may feel that this would suggest that their schools have a particular problem. We think that culture needs to change. It needs to be much more open, much more transparent, so that teachers are being actively supported by their schools and by the local authorities to report these incidents, and thereafter the action is taken, some kind of tracking thereafter, so that you can see, well, where do the resources need to lie? Where do we need to invest to actually address the problem and change the culture? So there is a cultural issue there that we absolutely need to address. And I was pleased to hear in the debate in Parliament the Cabinet Secretary referring to the importance of trusting teachers. We not only need to trust teachers, we need to support them in being able to deal with this.
Mike Corbett.
Thanks. Just to focus on that key point then, Pam, about fear of reporting. We have got a cultural problem. And I suspect that has come originally from very well-intentioned aims to reduce exclusions, for example. But one of the unintended consequences of that, I would suggest, is that local authorities obviously get violent incidents from schools reported to them, and exclusions, etc. And we would say, our members certainly tell us, that there's increasingly been a culture of fear almost among head teachers who don't want to report a large number of violent incidents because that makes their school look bad. They don't want to exclude sometimes because that makes their school look bad. So it's definitely a cultural issue and pressure on local authorities and head teachers. And it may be because they've misunderstood the guidance, but that absolutely leads to situations where individual teachers feel they are dissuaded, as Stephen touched on earlier, from actually reporting violent incidents and abuse. And just to give you one anecdotal example, we put in a couple of anonymised examples as part of our evidence to the committee. We had an example from a teacher who was subject to homophobic abuse, who was going to, you know, flirted with the idea of, yeah, we could put in an anonymised example of your experience, your terrible experience. And at the last minute, he withdrew that, despite the fact it was anonymised. And I think that shows you, you know, the fear that's there, although that also touches on a wider societal issue about particularly online abuse of minorities at the moment. So, yeah, there's societal things here as well. But I think that fear thing and the lack of full reporting is important.
Please. On that point, I think is really important. In your, I think it's either your submission or EIS submission, you talk about the violence definition, including written. Do you think it also needs to include online abuse?
I think now, because, I mean, you know, if you look at certainly the past 18 months, teachers generally and our members amongst them who are part of protected groups, whether that's, you know, disabled members, but especially Black members and LGBT members have suffered a terrible increase in online abuse. Yeah, so I think that should be a part of it.
And are we recording that?
As I've just said, I mean, I think there's a culture that dissuades some of that recording. So we're back to, do we have the full picture or not? We've got a lot of information, but we would still say in some ways we don't quite have the full picture.
Carrie Lindsay next, and then Cheryl's wanting to come in as well.
Mike referred to some of the things that we've done in Fife, but I don't want to focus on Fife, but we have put an app on the laptop of every member of staff so that whenever they go into a computer, the app is there, that they can then very quickly submit their evidence about their concerns. And I think that society, unfortunately, though, that when you start to gather that information, it becomes a problem as well as a solution. That, you know, people will then look at that information, that data. Our local politicians will look at that information, that data, and we'll see it rising because we are encouraging and we want to get a full picture. But sometimes that becomes a bit skewed, so we have to be careful with how we use that data. And we use it very regularly with our trade unions and have discussions about the responses that we'll do, as will many of my colleagues. And I know we had a session with all of the directors on looking at this topic, and lots of information was gleaned about forums, organised meetings that they're having with trade unions to try to make sure that we are encouraging staff to do that reporting and that we're making sure that we're using that to inform what we do next, because it's not just about having the data, it's about what you use it for. And I think that, you know, we need to be able to respond locally to the data that we have, because we know what resources we have, we know what training, what support we can do. And I think we're now starting to see that kind of targeted approach, so that if people have that data, they can use it to target in some ways. I think there is something about the feedback, I think, that Anne touched on, that sometimes the feedback is quite difficult because some time might have elapsed because of a gathering of information if it's going through various health and safety. Sometimes it's about finding time in the school, and certainly we've done a lot of work with the head teachers to try to make sure that they make that an absolute priority to give that feedback to anybody who has been involved in any situation. But that is a challenge.
And again, we were gathering from a range of different local authorities the kind of numbers that they have, and it is less than 1%. And not saying that it's not a national, and it's just something that we've been looking at. It's less than 1% in most of our settings, apart from in the additional support needs. So they're called a range of different things in different places, whether they're special schools or departments of additional support. But it is less than 1% for most of the other settings.
And 1%, do you mean
the recording of the violent and aggressive incidents?
So how does that compare then with the data that we're hearing from others today about the 17% of people who are experiencing physical assault, or the 62% of people who are experiencing?
I can't comment on that. I don't have that data. I don't see where that evidence is coming from. So that's the
okay.
The data
I think that kind of gets to the heart of the problem, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, all I can talk about is the data that I've been looking at through the directors that have provided that for me. And the last point I just wanted to make was about our young people feeling safe in school. And I know that in one local authority, on the back of an incident that had occurred, that they went out to all of their secondary schools and did focus groups with all of them. And over 90% of the young people said that they did feel safe in school. Now, still, there are some that are not saying that they feel safe. But I think, again, it's to give it that perspective, just to what was said.
Okay.
Cheryl, can I come to you on this topic, and then I've got Ross Greer wanting to pop in another question.
Thank you, Convener. It's just in the reporting. I've got to link back to parents as well, because obviously we're talking an awful lot about staff, and I appreciate the reasons why. But the other side of this coin is us as individual parents making that initial conversation to report that initial concern. For parents, they assume, maybe wrongly so, that when they have a conversation, a phone call, maybe an email or some sort of interaction with the school to raise a concern, that it's noted down, it's jotted down. But the reality is, for parents, many don't know when that is actually becomes a recordable incident. Again, it's very, very murky waters as to what defines a sort of recordable, notifiable incident. For many parents, for example, taking the example of bullying behaviour, challenging behaviour in schools. So if you have a young person who is maybe directly impacted of the result of a behaviour of a young individual within a school setting, or even sometimes it kind of fluctuates between the school and within the community, and kind of it crosses both sort of sides. I think we have to be clear that parents are unsure of the process. There is no clear way, and there's no clear process given to us or shown to parent councils or parents what's the right way forward. So understand that teachers and staff are a wee bit confused about what the right process is, because it is a postcode lottery. But that's the same for parents too. Mm-hmm. I mean, okay. When we make an initial report, it can get lost in translation, and that little molehill suddenly becomes a mountain, and you get the extreme side of that.
Useful comment there. Ross Greer, over to you.
Thanks, Camille. The point that Mike made about reporting not just the instance, but making sure that what's motivated it has been accurately reported, particularly when it involves a protected characteristic, is really important. I'd be really keen to hear from others on that, because I'm aware that the Thai campaign for LGBT inclusive education made exactly this point, that often violence against queer pupils or staff was being recorded as a generic incident of violence, and that motivating factor wasn't being recorded. I'm personally not remotely convinced that we're accurately recording violence against young women and girls where misogyny is the motivating factor. So I'd be really keen to hear from others on that, whether you believe that there's an issue there as well. But I'd also like to specifically ask Carrie about the health and wellbeing census, which you mentioned, because there's really valuable data in that. I'd be interested to know how local authorities and schools have used that in the past to inform their policies around bullying and violence, and how that could be used this year, given the highly politicised discussion that took place around the census this year and the very variable return rate that we got for it. Is it as usable now for this specific purpose as it was in the past, given that I'm aware there's some schools that got a 95%, 100% response rate, and other schools and entire local authorities who didn't actually take part at all? Can we actually use that data this year in the way that we've done in the past?
Is there one person looking to respond to Ross? It might be... Yep, Carrie, okay.
Yeah,
it'd have
thanks.
To be very short.
You'll be aware that there were some local authorities that weren't able to participate in the health and wellbeing census for a range of reasons. And so, therefore, the national data that you could say was there was incomplete. I think that you'll always have, you know, good responses from some places and not so good from other. But if you're looking at it nationally, then I think in response to your question, I think it does give you good information to start from. I think local authorities will also do their own gathering of information like that, which is why some of them perhaps have not bought into the health and wellbeing census, because they were already doing some of their own. So I think there is a wealth of data that people can use to be informing the policies and the practice in their own local authorities. So again, I think that yes, that health and wellbeing census data at a national and at a local level should be used to inform policies and procedures.
Ross, Bo would like to respond to your questions as well.
I think the point you raised about people from different kind of backgrounds, such as LGBT people and young women, is particularly important for young people. As I was saying before, although violence isn't necessarily an issue that's been brought to us as a concern of young people, not necessarily meaning that it's not an issue, just that it hasn't been brought to us, things like bullying of LGBT plus people and kind of homophobic and biphobic, transphobic behaviour has definitely been brought to us. We have lots of policy on that, such as there should be a dedicated fund for initiatives to educate, prevent and address LGBT bullying and discrimination in all schools. And that passed with 74%, showing that a lot of young people feel that this is definitely an issue. We also have a women's working empowerment group that has been established because we feel that kind of women, young women need support, so it's kind of looking at doing that. So I think that's definitely a big issue for young people, is kind of the discrimination element of this as well.
Thank you. And in the interest of time, actually, I'm going to move on to some questions from Ruth Maguire now, if that's okay. Ruth, thanks very much.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Appreciate all your experience and expertise and different perspectives. I want to talk specifically about children for a wee while, and initially to talk about, or to ask about, listen to you tell me about your perspectives on the factors and the things that increase incidents of violence or violent behaviour. Nick Smiley, in opening, you touched on some of that. I wonder, can we look at it in a bit more depth, and then I'd like to maybe chat about potential solutions. Colin Morrison spoke about relationships and how having good relationships can be preventative and protective. So maybe we could talk a bit about that as well.
Thank you. I suppose to go back to something that was said earlier on in terms of the language and talking about violence and so on. Again, I find that sort of, I'm not comfortable with that in terms of talking about children's behaviour, but I absolutely accept the concerns around the issue of harm that's being caused. In terms of behaviour and incidents where people are hurt and things that occur like that, children with additional support needs are overrepresented in that. There's no doubt about that, and people will know that from the papers and stuff that were submitted before. So there's a fundamental issue about how we understand children's needs and how we support them in the context of school. And the whole area of additional support for learning is one. Obviously, there's been the Morgan review and so on, but I think that needs to be looked at as well in terms of just how we support children. So the issue in terms of the incidents that occur and that are causing a lot of concern and alarm, I would say in the vast majority of incidents, it's distressed behaviour. It can be viewed through a prism or a lens of trauma. I would say that we have more children presenting with neurodevelopmental needs. The combination of those needs, along with perhaps traumatic experiences or needs not being met out with school, etc., results in situations, some things in school that are very difficult to manage. And the age of children that are presenting with those needs has got younger, in that I would say it's quite clear now that even as young as in early learning and childcare, we have children who come in to school who require a lot of support, who just the environmental situation is very demanding for them, and trying to meet their needs poses challenges. I wouldn't talk about violent behaviour in those contexts, but there are children who become distressed and cannot cope, and they communicate and express their their needs through behaviour, which is difficult for staff to deal with.
I appreciate what you're saying, and pardon my using the wrong term. I suppose, you know, we've acknowledged that children with additional support needs are a large cohort. I think the thing that drives some of the discussion around this is not that, it's the examples that people see of children and young people causing physical harm to other children and young people, not through those. I appreciate that all violence is caused by distress behaviour, but
I think in those situations, then obviously I would echo what other people have said about the need for relational approaches, about the culture and ethos of schools, about how we support young people to understand their emotional needs and how they, cope in situations where there is conflict. I think they're probably, because of the impact of the pandemic and key developmental sort of experiences for some of our young people, they've missed out on them. And I think for some of our young people I would say, for instance, children who were impacted by lockdown around the time when they were coming to the world towards the end of primary school, and then that supported transition for a lot of our children who would have had an extended transition into that new environment, that we weren't able to do that. And we have a whole cohort of young people, particularly those with more complex additional support needs, who have struggled to settle and find a secure base in secondary school, despite a lot of work. And you have to bear in mind that even once lockdown, etc., was over, there were still measures in place that meant schools were restricted in what they could do around bringing children in from primary to secondary. So that whole transition sort of area, I would include from nursery into primary school as well, the impact on those transition experiences was significant. And I think we still have a legacy from that. And I think we have young people who don't, levels of social anxiety are significant, and some young people aren't able to navigate the social environment of school in the way that perhaps they were before. So perhaps there are more incidents in terms of conflict arising out of that. But I think in terms of what we have, and there's been a lot of discussion about data and how representative data is, but locally, in terms of my own authority, we see that probably the biggest increase is in a younger age group. It's not in secondary school. And the incidents which are more serious and where people are hurt are almost always complex situations of children and young people with significant additional support needs. So in our specialist provision, it's probably where there are the most number of incidents that would be recorded, but they arise out of complex situations with children with very significant communication needs who can become very distressed and will express that through sometimes what you would term violent behaviour. But I mean, the intention is not there. But those are the most serious incidents. So in my experience, where staff are hurt is in that context of very complex additional support needs. So I don't think you can separate that necessarily from the wider discussion.
Thank you.
Colin Morrison.
Thank you. Yeah. I think if you're looking for evidence, an explanation about why the P1, P2 child is picking up their desk and causing chaos through their distress behaviour in the classroom, then I would really encourage you to read the Public Health Scotland's work around their COVID-19 early years resilience and impact surveys. So the fourth one is live now. And that's big scale data that tells us what happened to the children that's just been referred to, the children who went through lockdown, the most vulnerable families who had, now I know it's easy to have hindsight and we've got a COVID inquiry going on, but the closure of early years, the closure of community-based services for the most vulnerable families, that's kind of coming home to roost now, I would say. So what we have is these 5 and 6-year-olds, the Public Health Scotland evidence, well if you read that, and it has a long tail, so these behaviours have become established. So there is a significant minority of 3, 4, 5, 6-year-olds who do not access green space or a garden at all in a week. They're not outdoors at all. Now, that's just a little thing that struck me this week when I was reading it. So please read that work, because these are not excuses. You know, we're not saying that these children are behaving badly because they get away with it, you know, which I think other people might suggest to you. These children are behaving in these ways because their lived experience has has been so shut down. Trauma is about disconnection and disempowerment. So we need to unpack what these things mean day to day, and not just for the wee ones, because it's also, it's harder to apply your empathy and your kindness to the 14, 15-year-olds, but they've pretty much gone through the same experience. So let's be kind to them all. In terms of solutions, there are solutions, but there are also things that we're pulling away from under the feet of, you know, I'm thinking about when you're on a flight and adults are told, you know, fit your own oxygen mask first. So for a children's organisation, we would say, look after the adults first, because if you're not doing that, you can't look after the children. So there was an event in Celsus in University of Strathclyde yesterday about a Wee Breathers programme, which is a trauma-informed programme that supports education staff to manage the kind of behaviours that they're coping with day to day. Barnado's published work 2 years ago, before COVID possibly, around the importance of support and supervision for education professionals, because it's pretty poor. There's often very little in a lot of settings. If you don't have time to be supported, if you don't have time to unpack, if you don't have time to grieve and loss and lose things, you know, understand loss yourself, if you don't understand, if you can't unpack what it feels like to have a five-year-old pick up a chair and throw it at you, then you're not able to adopt the kind of approaches and the good, we have good policy, you know, included engaged and involved part two about school exclusions is good policy, and we can't see an unpicking of that because of our anxiety and our worry about what's happening to people. So the reason that we have fewer exclusions in Scotland now is because we've all worked so hard before COVID to make that so. So another, you know, one more thing I'll just throw in. I've heard that four local authorities, at least in the last week, I've heard, are closing their school libraries. Mm-hmm. School libraries are a place of sanctuary. They're a place where a kid who's struggling can go, not stand in a corridor, but go to a library, get a book, be read to. In some schools, the librarians take in their dog. You know, it's that kind of therapeutic space. Mm-hmm. We can't say that we really want to deal with these things if we're not dealing with the reality of what we're taking away and what we're not providing the adults in school settings to be able to do their job properly.
Thank you, Colin. I've got Bo that would like to come in. I've got a list, actually, Ruth, if you don't, I can go through them.
Yeah. Yep. I think what Colin was touching on about the kind of not looking to turn to exclusions as a kind of method for this, but looking at kind of preventative strategies, I think there's four kind of key issues that play into this, so youth work budget cuts, education reform, cooperation of UNCRC and the lack of availability of mental health support. Youth work is an essential kind of factor in this. It provides so much support for so many young people, not only to help them develop their skills and find a route out of poverty, which could be causing this violence, but also as mental health support and at building those relationships with people that mean you have somewhere to vent, you have somewhere to kind of be, I've had a really bad day, can we talk about this, rather than taking that out through your actions. And obviously with the budget cuts, those resources are less kind of available to young people now, which also leads into the kind of green space thing. Youth work can provide green spaces and things like that, which allows children and young people to be in green spaces and kind of have that as a solution as well. And with budget cuts to youth work, that's becoming less and less available to children and young people. Second point on education reform, I think a lot of the feeling in Scottish Youth Parliament is that the current education system isn't designed to kind of help children and young people reach their full potential. And that can create quite a difficult environment in school for young people, where they don't feel like their mental health is well supported by the education system. And it's not designed to kind of look after them and make sure that they're learning in a safe way for their mental health. And then lack of availability of mental health supports. So obviously we know that there's a lack of kind of mental health support available because it's post-pandemic. There's been a lot of demand for it. There's two kind of strategies to resolving that. So it can be preventative spend, so like spending in youth work as a preventative strategy, but also spending in community-based mental health services. Scottish Youth Parliament did a kind of project on that to look into the effectiveness of community-based mental health services, and we found that they were incredibly successful for helping children and young people with their mental health,
but there needs to be investment to expand the services and make sure that that funding is kind of streamlined so that it's available for children and young people. And finally, incorporation of the UNCRC. I think children and young people don't necessarily know where their rights are because they're not incorporated into law currently, which then means that they're not able to be like, right, well, what's my rights in this space? Where can I kind of go to for help, and what areas there are, and where, like, how they can kind of rely on the UNCRC and their rights set out in that to make sure that they're being protected and looked after.
Thank you. Thank you, both. Dr. Mowat.
I would endorse all the points that have been made so far. I think, as you know, building on relational approaches is very important within this context. And I think approaches like nurture, for example, school counselling, have got a great deal to offer in that respect. I think one of the issues is, you know, we're highlighting that a lot of the issues are around additional support for learning. And unfortunately, that tends to be the very first thing that goes when there are budget cuts within local authorities. And support staff are often, often made redundant. So I think finding some way of ring-fencing that support for children would be very valuable. I think we need to, I think what Colin was talking about was empathetic approaches towards children, but also towards staff. And I think, building in high quality initial teacher education on relational approaches and also career-long professional learning in that regard is very important. But also developing strong partnerships with parents. They're the people who know their children best. So listening to parents as equal partners, I would see as being an important aspect of this, as well as the issues about trying to increase access to CAMHS, for example, which is a very difficult thing just now. So I think these are all things I would say would help to address the issue. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Mowat. I've got a list here now. We've got Anne and then Carrie and then Mike. If we can keep things tight. Thanks.
Thanks, I'll do my best. There has been a lot of discussion around relational approaches, and I completely agreed. Relational approaches underpin our approach to ASN. I think what we have to realise is that in Scotland we have fantastic legislation, we have fantastic policy on ASN, but it's meeting the gap between policy and practice. And from our perspective, that comes down to resourcing. This isn't a new thing. We've been raising this for a number of years. In fact, the predecessor to this committee, I think the Education and Skills Committee back in 2017, raised the importance of resourcing. We come back to it again. We had hoped when there was the announcement of the Morgan Review that this would shine a light on it. However, resourcing was missing from the Morgan Review. So we have to come back and actually face the fact that if we want good relational approaches in our classrooms, then we have to pay for that. We have to resource teachers. We have to have enough teachers on the ground. We have to have enough pupil support workers on the ground to support that. And that means more investment, smaller class sizes, a promise that I think was made back in 2007 in the manifesto commitment then that hasn't been realised. We need reduced class contact time with more preparation for teachers to be given over to developing differentiation. But the smaller class sizes would allow much more meaningful engagement of with pupils, with parents and with support agencies. We also need more resourcing in the support agencies. We've heard about the lists for CAMHS. We know about difficulties with speech, trying to access speech and language therapy report for our youngest learners, with psychologists. So there's a whole host of investment that needs to go into that. And essentially, we need to look at the whole recovery agenda, because we haven't really... Mm-hmm. There's been a drive to get back to normal, to go back to... looking at attainment statistics, to top-down accountability measures. We need to go back and look meaningfully at recovery for teachers, for children and young people within our schools, and that needs a package of resources.
And I know some of the solutions that you're discussing there, I know that some of the members will be picking into that later on. So, Carrie Lindsay.
Yeah, recently I listened to the lead from the Violence Reduction Unit in Strathclyde, or not called Strathclyde anymore, is it, in Glasgow City Council, about the significant increase in antisocial behaviour in communities. And I think that this isn't just a school problem, and I think that, we're kind of, I suppose, if we put it into that pocket, then we're maybe not doing justice or going to have the biggest impact. So for me, there is a big thing that I agree exactly with what Bo said about youth work, about mental health support, and also about active schools, about getting our young people engaged in groups, engaged in activities, so that they aren't just at home and they aren't just on the computer and doing the work that's very isolated. So I think that for me that's crucial, that we have to think about that as a wider society. I just also wanted to touch on just something that Colin was saying about the, you know, the nursery into primary one and the S2 and S3, which is the transition that we're seeing into the secondary schools, that it's not just about their behaviours, it's about their attendance. That what we're seeing is that families, they didn't send children to school in the pandemic, so they don't, some of them haven't re-engaged with that value of schooling. So we have a real problem with attendance, and particularly with some school refusers, where young people with the anxiety that they are displaying, where they really can't attend. And that interrupted learning means that it's really difficult to do a personal social education programme with a group of young people, because they're not there all the time. So how do you try to, you know, input some of the areas of work that you would be trying to do to get them to share, to get them to work together when they're only attending? I visit schools every week, and you know, even in the nursery school settings, sometimes where there should be groups of 20 children, there are maybe 6 or 7 children coming in that day. They might be coming in over the course of the week, but they're not coming in every day. So there is something about how we shift that, and I suppose one of the solutions that I would certainly be thinking is that, you know, collectively as a society, we have to try to make sure that people start to revalue education and attending school, and that we think about how the whole society is that bit about, you know, it's the whole village, isn't it? It's not just the people that are in the schools that are going to make this difference.
Thanks, Carrie. I've got Mike, and if you keep it tight, Mike, I've got Michelle as well.
I'll try. I mean, much of what's been said, you know, obviously there are factors there that I think attempts are already made to address those. So, you know, trauma-induced approaches, recognising the distress in young people, recognising adverse childhood experiences, the explosion really in additional support needs, now recognising post-pandemic issues. So there's lots of good work already going on there. But that work needs resource, as has been touched on. It needs the ability to do small group one-to-one work with a lot of those distressed children. And I'm not convinced that resource is there. But many of you do know that I've got 25 years' experience in the classroom, and there is another element. And for me, it was your teenage boys in the secondary school who would swear at the teacher as performance, as show-off, you know, in front of their pals. Now, yes, you maybe need to dig down into, well, why is that going on, etc. But, you know, there's more to it, and there's other elements that I think, you know, we need to explore as well. And that, I suppose, brings me round to one of the big issues that, again, has been touched on, is I think there's a lack of independent research on what are the reasons driving this, particularly post-pandemic. So I think we would really like to see some more independent research on, right, what are the key factors that are driving this. But just to touch briefly on, because the mention has been made of relational approaches, etc., and, you know, you can change your approach, you can change the language of your approach, but it doesn't necessarily change the behaviour. So I've got evidence here about a new positive relationships policy that our members were suggesting meant that low-level indiscipline wasn't being recorded anymore, there was more disruption, restorative approaches were used, but often with the same pupils day after day, they didn't seem to improve behaviour, and so on. That's from February 2019, right? That's a school in February 2019, trying to, in their view, do the right thing, but, you know, a lot of these approaches have been tried, and in some situations, in some schools, they're not always working. So I think that needs recognised as well. But the broader things, I think the Morgan Review, I've said this before to committee, just seems to have been forgotten about almost. I think there's that really needs to be refocused on about ASN. And yes, I mean, a number of points have been made that there are broader societal issues there. You know, the youth work, the libraries one is absolutely vital. I used to be a teacher of English, so I have a big view on that. And these things are absolutely vital as well to try and improve things more generally for young people. Thanks.
Cheryl, would you like to come in on this?
Thank you. It's just in response that I absolutely wholeheartedly agree about youth work. That's something I'm very heavily involved in out with my national parent role, and I absolutely recognise what you were saying about the strains of young people being able to obviously cope with obviously the pressure of being in school all week and coming back to a community to feel where they feel safe so they can obviously re-regulate their emotions. But for me, first and foremost, it has to be a community-wide approach. I mean, we're still talking school-centric here, and the reality is this is not just a school problem. We have to be able to work with every other part of health. And if you look at allied health professionals, we've talked about obviously educational psychologists. What about obviously health visitors? What about all the people who have got key responsibilities at the transitional points of a child's journey from like birth onwards? I think there's a duty and responsibility. Again, I have to agree with the lack of funding. That's a huge issue on resources. It's fundamentally and detrimentally impacting children, young people, but also we've talked about education reform. You're looking at this lifelong learning we're talking about now. We're not no longer talking about 3 to 18, we're talking beyond. Now, the impact of what we're seeing now is going to continue on. We see that spilling in not just inside school, but outside school in our local communities. It has to be a community-wide approach. All of us need to be on the same page. It can't be the sole responsibility of a school. And I go back to what Anne's point about the robust policies and legislation. Absolutely there is. And there was a lot of hope with Angela Morgan's review and the recommendations with that that would shine a light and effectively create this change. I'm hearing the same things from parents day in and day out. Nothing has changed, and for that we have to really put our money where our mouth is and be able to solidify that we can actually present workable and meaningful recommendations that we can take going forward. But for me, funding has got to be the biggest barrier to success.
Thanks, Cheryl. And just sort of make comment on some of the discussion there about the Morgan Review. On the 8th of June 2022, we did minute that it was our intention to do an inquiry into additional support needs. And we are scoping, in 2 weeks today, we're having our initial discussion at committee around that and what that might look like. So it is very much on our radar as well. And carrying on with that theme of additional support needs, can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan as well now, please?
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for all being here today. It's been really interesting, a really wide-ranging conversation as well. I want to talk a little bit about bullying as well within schools, so when we have children harming other children too. And additional support needs, yes, quite often their behaviours are an issue, but very, very often as well they're on the receiving end also. So the Morgan report's already been mentioned, and I think the strategies for additional support needs, we know that those work for all children and young people, so that's certainly something going down the line, and there's been a lot said. So a couple of wee points that I'm interested in, you don't all have to answer all of them. I'm interested in us talking about trauma and COVID and poverty and mental health, and are there wider approaches? Should we be looking to teach strategies to all of our young people to actually be able to cope better with the challenges that they have just now? Secondly, as well, I'm interested in accountability too, because accountability is part of it. Absolutely, it's about relationships and it's about supporting young people whose behaviour isn't what we would be hoping for it to be. But also sometimes is there that permission and kind of getting away with it and not being held accountable, which isn't good too. And thirdly, as well, infrastructure. Are our schools just really, really big? And I'd be particularly interested in hearing from Joan, Nick, Colin, Cheryl, or some of you. Thanks.
Joan, would you like to come in first? Is that possible, or is that too much of a hot seat?
No, could you just remind me quickly of your first point, please? Was it about all children being informed about trauma-informed?
Yes, so about a wider approach that actually teaches our young people strategies for their own well-being, mental health, or to deal with anxiety, etc.
I would totally agree with that, because I think developing understanding
in children and in adults is a starting point for any positive change. So I think that is a really positive suggestion. I think there is work already going on in schools. There's work around resilience, for example. There's a lot of good work going on in social and emotional learning programmes. I do take the point about absence in schools, which is a particular problem at the moment. In terms of accountability, it depends on what we mean by accountability. In my view, accountability is being able to take responsibility for your own actions. That, and I think the best way to do that is actually through discussion, through listening to children, through providing restorative approaches, you know, the opportunity for that. Accountability doesn't necessarily mean sanctions. And sanctions don't, you know, we know from long experience that sanctions don't necessarily work. If you look at the approach down south, for example, where there's a lot of emphasis on zero tolerance approaches, their exclusion rates are soaring. We don't want to go in that direction. I think there is, you know, to answer the point about the research and restorative practice and nurture and things like that, there is quite a significant body of research on this, but that doesn't mean to say that in a specific context, in a specific situation, that it won't fall down. And I would agree that there is need for further research, just to pick up on that point. And I think in terms of infrastructure, I have long argued in my own research about the need to build an infrastructure of support around communities, around schools, around families, around children. And what I mean by that is what's already been mooted by many people around the table, all the different, you know, as I think, as I said in my own paper, this problem can't be solved by schools alone. It's, you need to have a multidisciplinary lens on it, and that means you need to look at all of the support services, home link workers, you know, community workers, you know, work with parents, all the different supports that are there to support communities and families and children. Are they all need to work in harmony with each other, and I know that's a very, very big ask, but I think just having that holistic view on the lives of children and families is absolutely crucial. Okay. If you're going to make any progress at all. And I think that probably means that every level of the system, from, you know, the local level right up to government level, these bodies need to be talking to each other. Housing policy, for example, you know, fiscal policy, all of these things come into the mix, and particularly around poverty, which I think, you know, and but also recognising that these things are not separate. Mental health, poverty, you know, school behaviour, they're all so closely linked. So you can't see them as just, you know, you can't put them into silos. They have to be looked at holistically. So I hope that answers your question from my perspective.
Thank you. Do you want to come in next, Colin?
Yeah.
It's the wrong mic. That's the right microphone now. There you go.
Thanks. Just following up, firstly, on something that Anne said earlier. Just coming out of COVID, we, Children's Parliament, pushed really hard for this idea of a recovery curriculum, and it's in the paper that was submitted earlier. And we failed in that. So what happened was that we jumped straight back into re-establishment of an exam diet, notions of lost learning, focus on attainment, and what we saw was many, many adults in schools trying to develop this recovery-based approach, talk about resilience, bring children back to learning, focus on health and well-being, whilst the pressures were coming down politically and organisationally to address literacy and numeracy testing, basically. That was a huge mistake, so we can... Hindsight is a fine thing when we looked at all the emergency measures during COVID, and I'm not doing that. What I'm talking about is a real decision that was made about how we would articulate a response educationally post-pandemic, and that did not do children and young people any service, never mind the adults in the environment. In terms of what schools do, I think absolutely a lot of good schools are focused on ideas of resilience and building confidence. Things like speech and language therapy, you know, I'm a huge fan. If speech and language therapy is a foundation for many of the issues that particularly boys bring in terms of behaviour, it links well to nurture-based approaches, but it's a very effective tool to give children language and space to think about their emotional well-being and to be able to talk about themselves and what they feel. So there's lots of these things that we know that do actually already work.
Bullying, we've done lots of work. We did an investigation around bullying pre-COVID, which I'll send you. So children have solutions for bullying, and they know that the absolute focus has to be on prevention, because once you're in the middle of a situation, it's very difficult to manage. We know that. But there are rights-based approaches to these things. Accountability is a really interesting one. You can't have accountability unless you have a basis of understanding for that. So for us, we talk about rights-based relationships being based on empathy, kindness, trust, and the core idea of human dignity. And if you embed these things in the way that you work with children from early years through primary and into secondary, then if they behave in ways that are unacceptable or targeting another person, then they have a foundation to be able to reflect on that. Was that kind? Was that empathic? Are you undermining trust? What does human dignity feel like to you? Why are you behaving like that? What have your experiences been that teaches you that behaving like that is acceptable? So you can unpack it and address it. There's absolutely a need to address. Bullying is the thing that comes up mostly when we speak to children about human dignity and what undermines it. Mm-hmm. It is endemic and it's problematic and it's made worse through social media. So a wee bit all over the place there, but can I just make one last plea? I don't know if any of you will have a long enough memory to remember, in 1995, the Kaluska-Benkian Commission on Children and Violence published, 1995, Kathleen Marshall, who was our first Children's Commissioner, was one of the commissioners. And that work, it's still available online, looked at the extent of the violence experienced by children. And we know that children are more likely to experience violence and perpetuate it, and they're more likely to experience violence perpetuated against them by adults, not by other children. So they looked at the experience of violence that children have, and they also looked at what we can do about that. So some of it would be children-on-children violence, but most of it isn't. And what they were looking for is something that I think we should... Maybe this Parliament passed the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child Incorporation Bill. Thank you for that. So how do you then step up and think in a bigger way about... We talk about having an alcohol-free childhood, a tobacco-free childhood. Why are we not talking about having a violence-free childhood? And what could we do to explore actual experiences? It goes back to data as well. What could we do to understand the experiences children have? And what are the strategies to make sure that whether they're at home, in school, or in the community, their childhood up to the age of 18 is experienced as a non-violent childhood? That, for me, seems to be the big question, in a way that we could try and pull all this together. I hear the concerns, but we need some kind of big idea around this to have better understanding.
Thanks, Colin. Bo, would you like to contribute next?
Yeah, thank you. It's just to kind of echo what's been said by Dr. Murray and Colin. I think there should be a restorative approach to this rather than a kind of punishment type approach. And I think it's essential that all these discussions should be framed in context of children and young people's rights. I've recently been to Geneva to hold Scottish and UK government to account on their obligations under the UNCRC. And the UN committee agreed with me and the other children and young people that I went with that a lot more needs to be done to ensure children and young people have access to their rights. I think a key kind of article of the UNCRC that plays into this is Article 12. So when you're talking about those as restorative approaches, children and young people need to be at the heart of designing them, and their voices need to be listened to within that process and work alongside kind of other decision makers to create those restorative approaches to tackle this kind of issue.
Thanks, Bo. Nick Smiley.
Yes. Thank you. I'm very aware of time, so I won't say too much. I agree very much of what Joan, Colin and Bo have said. They've covered most of probably what I would want to say. I'll just make a couple of points.
Thanks.
Quickly. And that, in terms of the original question, universal supports in school absolutely are essential. We would always want to do things in a sort of staged way, from universal targeted to intensive, and we need the supports at all those levels. So in terms of teaching all children about respect and emotional regulation and all that, absolutely we need to be doing that. Carrie made the point about the impact of attendance on that kind of work, and that is disrupting what we would want to do for some young people. The other couple of points I would make was, one, just in terms of, again, going back to the impact of the pandemic and the increase or perceived increase or agreed increase in terms of issues around behaviour and violent incidents. I think one of the things we need to be really aware of is the impact of the pandemic and the restrictions on young people's sense of connectedness, their sense of connectedness with school and with their communities. And if they don't have that affiliation with school, then they're much more likely to get involved in behaviours that we would see as disruptive or concerning. So I think there has been an impact on that connectedness, and that's something that we really need to continue to support and work on. And I absolutely agree with the points about holistic support and community-based support, and that schools can't deal with these issues on their own. And the final point I wanted to make was just in terms of what we've said about resources for ASN and the exponential increase in additional support needs. I would just quickly illustrate that point by some of the data that we have in terms of ASPEP, which is that back in 2007, the ratio of educational psychologists to children with identified additional support needs was 85.8 children per psychologist. This is based on the Scottish Government's data around additional support needs. In 2022, we have 659.7 children per individual psychologist. So there is that exponential increase in reduction in resource.
Thank you for getting that number on record. I've got now, Carrie, Stephanie Callaghan directed the question to you initially. Would you like to add anything further, or Cheryl? Cheryl wants. Sorry, that was me, because Cheryl wants to come in on this. So that's fine. Apologies, Carrie. Cheryl.
That's okay. Thank you so much.
Thanks for keeping me right, Stephanie.
Break down what you spoke about. So first and foremost, bullying for me is massive. It's a majority of parents. That's one of the predominant concerns, is the impact of bullying behaviour on their young person as a result. But one of the positives I will say is there's a lot of work nationally being done on reviewing the National Anti-Bullying Strategy. There's currently a Respect for All working group looking at that particular thing and how that's recorded, reported and breaking down some of the things that have been spoken about today. I think, Respect Me, the National Anti-Bullying Charity, has been at the forefront for supporting parents and carers, children and young people. National Parent Forum have done a lot of work alongside them to ensure that the guidance is there. I think the reality is, though, for parents, there's a misconception about where these policies sit at a very individual school level, because you have a national policy, it's there, it guides and drives all this robust recommendations and what you should be doing. But the reality down to implementation is each individual school creates its own individual policy, taken from the national to the local to individual. I said, and there's a lot of variation where parents don't know where these policies exist, because they don't all make it clear that it is a bullying policy. It can be back down to what we're discussing today about behaviour and relationships. I think there's another serious sort of concern around the infrastructure. You talk about capacity. When you look at a primary school, nursery and primary school, the environments are set up to be a nurturing, safe, welcoming environment, very heavily focused in the nurturing awards and the flags and stuff for the ambassadors for nurture. You get to a secondary school at the moment and the reality is they're not built to support all these lovely, fantastic initiatives. They're built to teach, and school buildings are limited in what they can actually be able to deliver. Specialist staff need to be funded, to be trained, to be resourced, to be able to support these children and young people going forward. And the reality is, it's great that we can do all these fantastic initials at a lower level, but where we struggle is that transition to secondary school, because then it becomes a whole different ballgame because you're focusing on teaching and learning. The problem you've now also got is the fact that you've got school counsellors in secondary schools, which is fantastic, but the reality is they can only see a very limited number of young children. And if you've got a secondary school with, say, 1,600 pupils, and that counsellor can only see maybe 10 or 15 children in a week. Sorry. That's okay.
Just to go back to something else that you said there. So, you know, we have the restorative practice, we have the relationships and things, but bullying is still happening, and it's a massive issue for parents.
Massive issue for parents.
So do parents feel there's enough focus then on what we can do to protect and support young people who are being bullied? Because what I do hear quite a bit, especially from neurodiverse groups, is that things are changed around the child that is being bullied. While the bully kind of goes on through normal schooling, they're maybe not going to classes, or they're not going to PE, or they're not going to extracurricular activities. And I'm just wondering if that's what you're hearing too.
It's a very, I'm going to say it's a postcode lottery. Again, it's back down to interpretation and availability, funding, resourcing, staffing. I mean, for parents, if you report an incident of bullying, as I said, it becomes that behind a hidden wall, because you don't know what the process is. And sometimes you feel that maybe an incident hasn't been, sort of dealt with in a timely manner, and to the perception of the parent, that's not to be detrimental to the impact of the school, who have a process to go through. But it's back down to what we talked about earlier about the recording. So you are quite right. There is a lot of focus on non-exclusion, so finding the sort of practice way not to exclude a child. But the reality is, in certain areas, there's not enough space or capacity, not just in the school building, having to use external provision, like you spoke about, Bo, about youth and family, so youth work. So in South Lanarkshire, where I come from, we have youth, family, community learning, and they do an awful lot of supportive work under education resources to ensure that these children get support and young people get support. Maybe that's not taking it away from just being inside the school. I think the reality, though, is it's hindsight is a wonderful thing. And absolutely, Colin said is absolutely spot on. If we could go back in time and know what we know now to try and change what we did then, we might be looking at a different future. But the reality for parents is that they just want their children to be safe. And yes, bullying is absolutely one of the biggest barriers and the biggest concerns that parents get deal with on a daily basis. And that has come out through our initial sort of survey. We're halfway through our survey, runs for another week, but our survey on behaviour has shown that bullying is absolutely one of the biggest factors towards us.
I've got Mike Corbett, but I'm going to give you can keep it tight because I've got my eye on the clock now, and we've got some other topics we want to pick at. So.
Okay, try my best. Yes, on bullying, I think that worries there, particularly about the reporting. And there's an Education Scotland report that's come out that highlights that, you know, the clunkiness of the CMIS system, and again, differences in different places. So I think that's an issue that needs looked at. But the accountability part, I think, is vital. And absolutely, the vast majority of pupils, of young people, who are dealt with via restorative justice type approach, do take responsibility for their actions, and that approach works with them. But in too many places, there is a vacuum above that. There's a lack of support from senior managers. The issue is often turned back on the teacher. Oh, well, your lesson wasn't entertaining enough to engage this pupil who swore at you. So, you know, that approach, and that's where you don't get the responsibility taken. That's where you get pupils, and again, I would say typically more in the secondary sector than the primary, who give this smirking apology. You know, aye, sorry for swearing at you. Now, what does that restore? How does that restore any trust? How does that restore any dignity for the teacher and for everyone involved? It doesn't. So that, for us, is a crucial issue. And I know we've had a lot of people talk about restorative approaches, and absolutely, they do work up to a point. But they're clearly, you know, not working wholly, or we wouldn't be here today. And just briefly, lastly, there's some touching on the UNCRC, which again is important. I think we'd like to see that, you know, getting incorporated soon. But I think it's important to see the UNCRC as not a pick and mix. Yes, Article 12 is important about listening to pupils' voice, but so are other articles about Article 3, about acting in the best interests of children more generally, about the right to education, Articles 28 and 29 of children more generally. So let us not forget the 29 others in the class when the one pupil has, you know, been violent or abusive or threatening. I think that's important to point out as well.
Thank you, Mike. Dr. Mowat, if you can come briefly, because I want to pick up on this.
Very briefly.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to talk about my own experience. As a deputy head at Vale of Leuven Academy, I became very despondent at the same pupil standing outside my door day after day after day, no matter what I did. What I found was that the only thing that made a difference for those pupils was actually investing time and effort and care and love in them. I developed support groups for those children where for most of the year, those children attended for a week, for an hour a week. And I trained staff within the school to work with those children. And it was that intensive work with them over a long period of time that actually began to show change in some of the sorts of children that you're talking about, you know, where the problems have become very intractable. So I think it's time, effort, love, care that needs to be invested, and that is a resource issue.
All right, thank you, Dr. Mowat. And in that theme of what happens in the classroom, can I come to Stephen Kerr now, please?
Yeah, so actually I was quite relieved to hear what you had to say just now, Mike, because I was beginning to wonder where the pattern of the discussion was going, because I would like specifically to refer to issues related to classroom management and classroom sizes and teacher training. But I'd like to begin with some words of a whistleblower reported in the Herald a couple of months ago, who was talking about the experience they were having. Now, I've got a suspicion that this relates to one specific school. So let me make the general comments that are reported in this news article, the quotes of the teacher. I've worked in schools in difficult places and it was not like this. Other places were run with precision and you could have great relationships with the kids because the place was so well structured and they felt safe. The whistleblower then goes on to talk about something called pivotal behaviour method, which apparently is a system based on restorative justice. The teacher then goes on, we can't pick apart what actually is policy, such as the citywide no exclusions policy, and what is some dogmatic theory that management seemed to be following. Senior management follow the script in terms of language, using very euphemistic language, so that even when you're having an informal conversation with a senior manager, you can't use terms like consequences. And when you speak to them, it's not like you're having a normal human interaction. And I think for the kids, it's very confusing. You always work with children from a place of kindness and empathy, but you're very clear with what you expect them to do and give them clear boundaries. And that is kind of backed up by Tom Bennett's evidence that he sent us. He talks about creating an environment in a school, in a classroom, where violence is... It is set as a culture that violence is unacceptable and where students incur instant penalties for doing so, where suspensions and exclusion are used as last resorts in the worst scenarios. Anything less than this fails to keep children and staff safe, which is the fundamental responsibility of the school. So what I'd like to hear is some comment on both the whistleblower's comments. I think you might actually, this person might be a member of your union, actually, judging by the way it was written. And this general approach of setting clear boundaries and for there being known sanctions, agreed perhaps indeed with the pupils, but known sanctions that are applied, including exclusions in the worst cases and in the last resort, that those individuals are not allowed to disrupt the 29 others, or perhaps physically or verbally continue to abuse.
Okay, or who are you addressing this to start with?
Well, I think I know what Mike might say.
Well, so, we'll start with Mike then.
Just a couple of things then. The pivotal approach comes originally from the book by Paul Dix, When the Adults Change, Everything Changes. And the problem with that has been seen as a one-size-fits-all approach imposed from above in a number of schools. And it's interesting that Paul Dix himself, in the book, says some interesting things that seem to have been forgotten or maybe never even part of the training in some local authorities and for some head teachers, which is, you know, children who misbehave need to experience an immediate proportionate consequence. He talks about behaviour management policies must be developed and owned collaboratively across a school staff. Those that are imposed from above are doomed to fail and so on. So we see the adoption of this pivotal approach not being a problem in itself, because at its heart are restorative approaches that can work, but a misinterpretation, a misapplication of it, and as I touched on earlier, a failure to give teachers the tools and the support to go to the next place. So I've tried, I've had my 10 restorative conversations. What do I do next? What support am I getting from above? And cover your ears if you're easily offended, because I've got a report from a deputy head teacher in a Scottish school that reported to me last week, probably happened 2 weeks ago, said to a probationer teacher, I get told to fuck off all the time. What makes you think you're special? Now, if that's the support that's been given to probationer teachers, no wonder a lot of our teachers are feeling that, you know, they don't know where to go next.
Or leaving the profession. So I'm happy to hear... Obviously, responses.
I understand that was obviously just as a warning. You know, that was obviously quoting, and you did make reference. But if we could maybe perhaps curtail,
we've had the ration language, of the one use of the F word.
Yes. Right. So, Stephen, you're asking who else were you?
Well, I think that we should do the EIS.
Anne Keenan.
Sure.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. We think that, you know, it should be the whole school approach to behaviour management, and that would be involving you know, everyone in the development of the behaviour policies. Mm-hmm. So you would want that empowered approach to develop that those policies, and then a common understanding of how they would apply, when it would be appropriate for particular sanctions to be used in certain circumstances, and very much part of the GRFEC approach. You know, this would be part of discussions that would be part of a child's planning process, discussions that would also... And I think we can't forget the health and safety. So we've spoken about, Mike referenced the UNCRC and the rights of the other children in the class, the rights... indeed of the person, the child or young person who is displaying the distressed or violent behaviour, but we also can't forget the health and safety rights of the teacher, which are enshrined in legislation, and this is a health and safety matter as well. So there's a number of competing rights there that have to be balanced, and there are circumstances that we have to embed within our behaviour management policies that ensures that everyone in the school is safe, and that then needs the support and the buy-in of everyone right the way through the school approach. So I think that level of understanding is very important. The children and young people need to know that level of understanding of the policies and practices, and when there may be consequences. And you know, we have in our policies for members set out very clearly what we would expect to be happening in certain circumstances and the supports that should be available for them. And I think that kind of common level of understanding needs to be applied across the school system. You mentioned retention of staff and the importance of that. Our recent survey, we asked the question, how many teachers intended to be in the profession 5 years from now? Only 51% said yes. And a large proportion, I think it was about 38% from memory, referred to the impact of distressed and violent behaviour on that.
So yeah, the EIS
of them, a number of them, I have to say, head teachers and deputy head teachers in that mix.
So the EIS doesn't have a no exclusions policy. Some of the councils seem to have a no exclusions at all cost policy. You don't support that?
We have very clearly said in our policy around violent and aggressive behaviour that there are circumstances when pupils should be excluded. And the reason behind that is partly because there needs to be risk assessments. So there's health and safety implications there that have to be undertaken in order that everyone can remain safe within...
But there should be something next, shouldn't there? The exclusion isn't banished.
Needs to be a clear understanding of the risk that is presented, the management of that risk, and what steps need to be in place moving forward to keep everybody safe.
I've got other folks looking to come in, Stephen, if that's okay, if you don't mind on this. Sure. Bo Johnson, then I've got Colin as well.
I think that approach should be avoided if possible, but if you are going to do that, I think it should be consulted on with children and young people and designed with children and young people to ensure that their rights are kind of at the forefront of it. Because the problem with exclusion is it is also like breaching rights within the UNCRC that Mike was mentioning earlier of 28 and 29, and it shouldn't be a situation where our most vulnerable young people are having their rights breached because of that. So it needs to be something that's designed with children and young people if that is going to happen.
So if they're excluded, they need to be excluded to something else. It needs to be a referral to somewhere else.
Yeah, there needs to be support in place for it, and that decision should ultimately be designed with children and young people, and that should be meaningfully listened to. So getting groups of children and young people, perhaps with lived experience of this, speaking with them and seeing, well, what would have helped you in that situation, actually having those discussions with children and young people and designing kind of the framework for this with them is kind of how you put children.
But you're not against consequences.
Pardon?
You're not against consequences for this sort of behaviour that we're discussing.
Me personally?
Yeah.
No, I've not experienced
that. Colin, can I come over to yourself now?
All behaviour has consequences. There are antecedents, there's a behaviour, and there's a consequence. And consequences can be good or bad, they can reinforce or they can change. So there's nothing wrong with the word consequences. But it's our job as adults to intervene at the point, at the antecedent, like what can we do to avert this behaviour, to intercede, to work with the actual behaviour when it's happening, and then to look at the consequences. What are the positive consequences that we can enact? So, for example, if this just gets lots of attention and there's nothing done to change it, then that behaviour will continue. I'm 5 years old, I'm distressed, I'm going to get lots of attention here. Obviously, the consequences, we understand basic psychology, forgive me if I get this wrong, punishment does not change behaviour. That's well established. So we just need to look at Pullman. Go and visit Pullman and speak to the young men there, and you will find that something like 80, 90% left school functionally illiterate and they were excluded by P7. These are the consequences of school exclusion. And the system in Scotland, please let's not lose everything we've gained. For the past 10, 20 years, we have worked really hard on exclusions. And it does not mean that children don't get the support or staff don't get the support. It's hard to deal with, you know, these kind of anonymised cases. We just take them at face value. And it sounds like that person is poorly supported and management is not behaving very effectively, it sounds like.
But it's very extreme, Colin, to say that we should have a no, we shouldn't have any exclusions because
that was my final point.
Thanks for reminding me.
I think Colin wants to come in on that point,
yeah,
Stephen.
The final point was there's no such thing as no exclusions at all cost policy. There's no such thing. There never has been and there never
will be. That's not how the teachers feel.
Well, you're using that language, so I'm just correcting it. So I'm saying there is no
such
thing.
Yeah, but I'm saying this is how the teachers feel.
Stephen.
You might contest me, but I'm telling you something that's factual. There is no such thing as a no exclusions at all cost policy. There are children and young people who are excluded from school, which would mean being moved to another setting, but it's very rare. But it does happen. So there is no exclusions policy, but there's been 20 years of work since whatever Better Behaviour, Better Learning that Joan knows well, that we have worked on our rates of exclusion and responses to behaviour. Thanks.
I've got Joan wanted to come in and then Nick as well.
I just wanted to say that I agree with the points that you were making about the need for a very consultative approach to and a consistent approach to discipline within schools in terms of relational putting relationships to the fore. But I think it's there is a danger if you begin to go far too far down the route of Tom Bennett, etc., where you begin to head towards zero tolerance policies, and there has been research that has shown that these policies just do not work in the long term. And I also think that the word consistent needs to be considered very carefully, because to me, you need to be consistent in your approach to treating every child as an individual and taking account of their individual circumstances. That does not mean going light on them. But if you have an approach where consistent means that every time something happens, X happens, Y happens, that is not actually in the best interest of children or their rights. So I think you need to have an approach that everyone understands, where there has been agreement, where children are consulted about, parents are consulted, children are consulted, there is agreement within the school, everyone understands that policy, but that policy is based on relationships, on trust, on empathy, on care, and yes, I agree with the
consequences.
I agree with the point that Colin made about consequences. There are always consequences.
Sanctions.
For behaviour. I think if you do go down the route of sanctions, they have to be appropriate and they have to be considered very, very carefully in terms of the circumstances of the child and taking full account of the context. I would never say that there is no circumstance where an exclusion would not be appropriate, but I think in the past we've been far too quick to go to exclusions, and I know as a deputy head I was under a lot of pressure to exclude children, and sometimes I had to work very, very hard to explain to a member of staff why I didn't think it was the appropriate thing to do in a particular context. So I would not rule exclusion out, but I think it has to be truly the very, very last result.
Thank you.
Not the first thing that you go to.
And on this, before I bring you in, Nick, Bo just wants to clarify something that she responded to there.
I just want to say I think I slightly misunderstood the final question that you asked me, but I just wanted to say that my viewpoint on consequences aligns with that of Dr. Morrison.
Dr. Morrison.
Oh,
No, Mowat.
No, Dr. Mowat and, yeah. And Morrison, I think it was both,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah, both.
Sorry. So Nick Smiley, please. Sorry about that.
Yeah, I'll just make a couple of points again. I agree very much with what Dr. Morrison and Dr. Mowat have said. I just want to make the point in terms that, you know, there's been quite a bit of criticism of restorative approaches, and I think one of the things that's important to say that structure and boundaries and limits are very much part of a restorative approach. And if there are issues about how it's being implemented or operationalised within the school, that may give a rise to some of the things that you talked about, but it does not mean the approach of itself is problematic. It's about how it's properly implemented, and there needs to be very clear structure, and that's absolutely a part of nurturing approaches and part of restorative approaches, and I think it's important to make that point. And the other point I just wanted to make was it can perhaps be seductive to think about sanctions and exclusions as being a solution when we know very much that they're not. The exclusions, as has been said already, that there isn't a zero policy, you know, a no exclusions policy. There are situations where it's an action that is necessary. But I think we always know that it doesn't actually move us forward in terms of the needs of that individual child or young person. And the last point I wanted to make was just that there was mention about exclusion to somewhere else. I think we have to be really careful. You know, the English system's been mentioned a couple of times in terms of zero tolerance, and they have these pupil referral units, and pupils are excluded from school and referred to pupil referral units. I think what we know about the sort of outcomes there for those young people is very, very poor, and those are not educational environments that are particularly supportive. We do need to have quality education environments, and we need to have options for children who we've got to a point where trying to support them within a mainstream environment has become too challenging. But the idea of just excluding children to off-site units is not a solution.
Thank you. And I do have two more people considering coming in here, keeping an eye on the clock. So can I come to Anne, very, very brief, and then Carrie, please, as well.
Just very briefly, I just want to say that, you know, I think it's unfortunate that really we're talking about exclusion, which is really a harsh alternative, because we're in a situation where we've got a lack of resources. If we had appropriate resourcing, we could have early intervention strategies that would address these issues, hopefully, and not have us having to consider anything of this nature.
Thank you. That might be a good segue into the final bit there. So, Carrie, over to you.
Very quickly, just two things. Just about the exclusions that, you know, in schools we use an exclusion to take a bit of time to then reintegrate a child with support back into the school setting. So at no point, or in my whole career, I think maybe one child that we've had to move to another setting, that it would not be an exclusion where a child's not returned to school. And I think there is a bit of misunderstanding that people think that an exclusion means that that child will not return to that school. That is not the case. The policy is around supporting the school, the family, the child, for them to come back into the school with appropriate support. And my last point was just to say that I do think we need to be really careful about individual comments about things that happen in individual schools, because that creates a false reality of what is actually happening. So,
That's something we didn't get to discuss today, the role of social media in terms of amplifying this, which I know we're not going to perhaps have time to give that justice. But can I come to Willie Rennie for some questions now as well, please?
I think we started off this session with quite a bit of anxiety that some people felt we were going to throw out some of the significant improvements that have been made over the last, well, certainly since I was at school, which was a wee while ago. And I've no doubt the system is much better. But there is also no doubt, whether the numbers have gone up or down or whatever, that we are getting significant numbers of concerns raised by parents and young people and teachers and staff about what happens in response to the incidents. And what I'm really wanting to focus on in this next session is the solutions. Now, many of you have come up with some really cracking solutions already. We've talked about many of them, about libraries and green spaces and youth work and mental health support, educational psychologists, issues around about resourcing in the Morgan Review, all of those things. I suppose my concern about those is that some of them are long term, and that doesn't make them bad, but they are long term, and that doesn't help the teacher that I spoke to last week, who showed me the bruises on her legs and the hair that had been pulled out from her head. And so it's whether we're missing something now about how we respond to these individual incidents when it's got, as Anne says, to this crisis point. I hear repeatedly that teachers are just fed up with doing the endless, repetitive, restorative discussion that goes nowhere. And what I want to really understand is it a failure of the application of the restorative approach effectively, or a misunderstanding of that policy, or is there something else we need to do in this situation? And we're not generalising here. We're not saying this is all the cases. I am not for going back to the old punishment ways of the past. I reject that. I'm a restorative approach supporter, but it's clearly a problem. And I want to focus on that bit of how do we deal with the incidents now where the teachers feel just helpless. And I want to understand what perhaps we're not getting quite right and how we can help those members of staff deal with this problem. Does that... Who would like to...
Oh, Anne? No? Anyone want, you want to kick off? Someone will put that on for you if you wait. Anne Keenan? Might be because we've got too many mics on. Dr. Mowat, if you could... That's fine.
No, don't touch it, it's fine.
Don't... Dr. Mowat's are still on and...
You're on now.
Anne's on now. Over to you. Sorry about that.
I think the word I would use, Willie, is time. Teachers need time to be able to develop these relational approaches. Our Edinburgh local association did a survey of staff members recently, and I was reading it last night in preparation for this session, and it was discussing restorative practices. One comment jumped out at me, which was, I can't really have a restorative practice, a restorative discussion with a pupil, because I've got 26 other children in the class waiting to be taught. So it was almost as if this was being segued into a quick discussion outside the classroom door. And if we are really going to invest in these practices, we need to give our teachers the time, the training, the space. And I come back to it, we need to look at the resourcing issues. We need to have smaller class sizes so that you can develop those approaches. We've suggested 20 as being a good, as our target for that. We are, we're sitting at some of the highest in the OECD countries, and we've had commitment after commitment to reduce class size, and we haven't seen that happening over the last, 16 years since that was promised. So we absolutely need that critical investment in education, in core education funding, not additionality, not PEF funding that can't be relied upon in years to come. We need core investment in education, smaller class sizes, reduce class contact time. It's a manifesto commitment at the minute. We've yet to see that brought to fruition, even to bring that down to 21 and a half hours so that teachers have more time. That's not happened. And we're sitting at the third highest class contact rate in the whole of the OECD. So those are things that is a government commitment, and yet we have not seen that given over to teachers' marking and preparation. We definitely need more investment in ASN specialists, specialist teachers, but also in pupil support workers. I referenced the statistics that came from primary colleagues about how that would impact on their wellbeing, but also on the reduction of their workload at the beginning of this session. It's huge. That could have a significant impact if we had more pupil support workers. And then we go to our... We can't look at relational approaches without looking at the multidisciplinary context. And to do that, we need investment in the other support agencies, in health and social work, to support education. We've discussed the societal impact of this, so we need that investment across the board.
Mike's looking to come in, will he? Mike
Yeah, just briefly. Yeah, I mean, time and resource is absolutely vital. And I do think that particularly in the secondary sector, it is more of a challenge sometimes to embed the restorative conversation approach when you've literally got six or seven classes one after the other and they're off
before you can have the chat. So there's an issue there about time. But again, those restorative approaches do still work for the majority of pupils. You know, what you're touching on again seems to be the what's beyond that. What's the next step before we get to exclusion? And that for us is, you know, better, more prompt support from senior management teams in schools. Now, that might be that they don't currently have the time to properly devote, you know, to taking a pupil out and you know, working with them one-to-one because they've got so many other things to do. But that's crucial. Again, we've got evidence over and over again where the next step up in many schools is a referral system where the teacher says, look, I've tried all I can and I've tried all my restorative approaches and I'm just not getting anywhere. And they refer it up to typically a deputy head in the school. But the number of, you know, examples of feedback we get from members who say, well, I've put in 10 referrals in the past month and I've not had any response to them. So again, there's clearly some kind of time issue there for those senior managers to deal with the problem and support those teachers in the classroom.
Could we come to Carrie? Are you able to?
I've got Cheryl wanting in as well, Willie. Cheryl as a peer and Carrie then. Yeah. Carrie.
Thank you for that. For me, there's the solution has got to be about strengthening guidance for parents and support for parents, because I know we're discussing again back into the classroom environment, but that's one element. These children still have to come home, and obviously we have to find ways to support parents to support their child. It can't always be the sole responsibility of a classroom teacher or a senior management team within a school. To give you an example, within our local, locally that I'm from, South Lanarkshire, we had during just probably post-COVID, just start post-COVID, we had a lot of issue with the sort of, I'm not going to, it's not a gang culture, it was a territorialism, back to that reality, the kids had nowhere to go. Started accumulating. We have our area formed a community safety meeting, and that was a complete whole-based approach with your head teachers, your police, your fire service, your housing, your community members, and obviously youth organisations. So it was a collaborative approach to try and resolve early intervention and prevention, so that it wasn't just based solely on the school having the sole responsibility. Because we have to realise that it's not just the responsibility of one individual. It was taking that wider collaborative approach, and it made such a difference in early intervention, because all the key people who were impacted and had the opportunity to be able to deliver a much-needed provision of service and those preventive models were around that table having that conversation. One of the other things I was going to say for parents in particular, I have to reiterate that there's not a one-stop shop for information. Most parents rely on information coming from the school. So as a parent, we have to at least be able to be signposted to where we can go to for support. And I think that's one of the biggest issues. There's a lot of judgment made that it's a parent's fault or the parent's responsibility. And the reality is that parent could have been shouting from the rooftops about trying to get their child or young person the right advocacy or support. But the reality is if they're not guided themselves and they're only getting information from particular areas, there needs to be a clearer signposting of communication and transparency about being able to showcase a parent where they can go.
Thank you.
I've got Bo wanting to... So can I bring Bo in first and then we can come to Carrie? Is that
sorry, okay? Just very quickly. I think if you're speaking, I think it has to kind of be a two-tactic approach. So I think you need to think about the long term, so things like youth work funding and things like that, but you also have to look at what's not working with restorative approaches. And I think part of that is bringing in, as I've said before, bringing in young people to the conversation, particularly those with experience of it, and asking them, right, what is going on here? How can we kind of make a system that works for you, that's not letting you get away with things that are maybe impacting your own right to education, but also ensuring that teachers are protected? So I think children and young people need to be at the heart of those conversations. And also, I think Dr. Mowat mentioned earlier about making sure that children and young people are informed on the process of that as well. My school has been particularly good at making sure that we know under what circumstances different kind of approaches will be taken. So I think it's really important that children and young people also are aware of kind of the approach taken by teachers in the school.
Thank you. Carrie Lindsay now. Thanks.
Yeah, I think it's important to say that individual circumstances are quite unique often. I think Mike referred to the fact that restorative approaches will work for the majority.
Yep.
So we are talking about the bespoke approaches that we need for individual youngsters. And sometimes they don't respond to a kind of hierarchical, if you do this, this happens, if you do this, this happens. So it is very much, and I suppose that's where sometimes it's difficult for people to understand that, because they think, well, this is the route for person A, but person B didn't respond to any of that, so there's a slightly different approach. And for me, that's where we do need to get better at working with our partners and thinking about alternative approaches to support that young person if the things that you're trying haven't worked. Now, I was a head teacher for a number of years, and I know that there were some circumstances where you tried 20, 30 different things, and the 31st thing was the thing that worked, and you really just have to stick at it. And I know that that maybe doesn't give people the confidence that you would want to say that actually if you do this, that'll work, because that's not the reality. And all schools are different. They have different leaders, they have different makeups of staff, they have, you know, sometimes really enthusiastic staff, sometimes staff that you're dragging, screaming and kicking. That's the reality. And I think that's why we have to look at every individual situation and find solutions that work for them. But there are some things that we can do on that universal basis to make sure we've got that grounding for everybody. And then the small resource that we do have, because I wouldn't argue that we wouldn't need more resource, of course, but there's a small resource that we do have, then we can actually use that in a targeted way to support wherever that's required. So we need to make sure that we're doing the trauma-informed practice, that we're doing the restorative approaches, that we're doing the de-escalation, that all of that is there in all of our schools as a foundation, a basis. And then we think about that multi-agency wraparound for those that are not being supported with that. And maybe just the last thing is about, in secondary schools in particular, where guidance staff are a key to be able to support some of that, and making sure that they have the capacity to be able to support the young people, because they do move around a lot, as Mike says, that you've only got them for 50 minutes or so, and it's a very different scenario. In a primary school, it's much easier to do that kind of relationship-based practice, and you can make time for it. I'm not saying it's easy, but you can do it. In a secondary school, that's quite different. So the guidance are really important there.
Joan Mowat.
I totally agree with what you've just said, and also the point that Anne was making about the difficulties around time in terms of restorative work. It's certainly in terms of seeing it as part of a much larger range of approaches that are used, it's just part of it. I think it's difficult to actually answer your question, because I just don't think we know the answer. I think there's a need for research. You know, if we're saying that restorative practice is the way ahead, then they need to understand why in certain circumstances it's not working as well as it should. So therefore, I think there is a need for research. We tend to be over-reliant on surveys. Qualitative approaches are much better at getting at the why of things. So I would recommend that we should be looking at that. There's certainly been research done in the past by people like Gillian McCoskey, Professor McCoskey at Edinburgh University, but I think there's a need for that. And I think we also, talking about the context of individual schools, we know that, for example, in schools of multiple deprivation, there can be very many more social issues that staff are having to deal with in the school, which may lead to them having difficulty finding time to deal with the number of things that come across their desk. And I think there's a need to understand this particular context of schools in multiple deprivation and the issues that they face in terms of behaviour, and how we can develop policies that best support those schools.
Okay, thank you. It's just wondering if Nick, if you want to come.
I just wanted to make a quick point again. In terms of what Willie said about that, teacher staff wellbeing is absolutely, a real important issue for us all. And I think one of the things is there's a lot of stress, a lot of pressure in the system. It was mentioned earlier on about supervision for teachers. I think that teacher needs to feel held, needs to feel contained, needs to have time to process what's happened to her or him. And we need to try and provide that. And that comes from prioritising, I suppose, that time within the school. But that's a difficult thing to do. So I suppose I'm not answering your question completely, but there is an issue there about how contained and supported that individual feels, and we need to do a better job of doing that so that they're able to process what's happened to them and feel supported and held by the school. If they are carrying a lot of unresolved worry and concern and distress, then that has to be addressed and supported.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for for what was a very good discussion, and thank you all for your time this morning. I think we'll find it's a very, very beneficial discussion, as I've just said. The public part of our meeting has now concluded, and we will consider our final agenda item in private. So thank you. Wait.